blazing fire of samsara afflicts us all like after life. But Gurudev is the tole, extinguishing this mortal strife.
Thank you. Divine Grace Kirtananda Swami Bhaktipad, who travels all over the earth preaching the glories of Lord Krishna. All glories to the founder Acharya of the International Hare Krishna Movement, His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. All glories to the previous Acharyas and pure devotees, especially Haridas Thakur, the Acharya of the Holy Name. All glories to Lord Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda, Advaita Gadadhar Srivas and their associates. All glories to Radha and Krishna, the cowherd boys and girls, the cows, Govardhan Hill, Shyamakund and Raikund. All glories to Vrindavan Dham, Navadweep Dham, the Ganges and Holy Yamuna. All glories to Tosi Devi and Bhakti Devi. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to Sri Guru and Gauranga.
Krishna, सक्सेसफुल हुए सारे संसार भर में बहुत से साधु लोग हैं। जब तक जो साधु जो बोलता है वो जब तक अपने जीवन में नहीं उतारे तो वो साधु कितना भी बोले उसकी कोई कीमत नहीं है। तो श्री गोविंद जी आज जिस सब्जेक्ट पर ऊपर बोले जा रहे हैं वो एक्चुअली इस सब्जेक्ट का विषय है संन्यासाश्रम। और संन्यासाश्रम के बारे में एक्चुअली जो जीते जागते और सामने उदाहरण जो है जिसका देखा जाएगा तो आप सन्यासी का मतलब ये नहीं है जो कि आपको बताने वाले हैं कि कोई ड्रेस बदल करके और भगवा वस्त्र पहन करके और जंगल चले जाने का। सन्यासी हमारे श्री गोविंद जी भी जो आपको बड़ा विचित्र लगेगा जो नए लोग आए हैं कई बार वो देखेंगे ये मंदिर में आकर के ये टाई लगा के ही इज कमिंग फ्रॉम द हॉस्पिटल डायरेक्टली। तो ये टाई लगा के और ये लेक्चर देने का ये मतलब क्या है? कहने का मतलब यह है कि जो व्यक्ति जिस आश्रम में रहता हुआ अगर जीवन का एकमात्र केंद्र भगवान को अगर वो मान लिया है तो वो सन्यासी है। और उसका जो है अपनी जीवन में किस ढंग से ये रहते हैं, कैसे खाते हैं, कैसे सोते हैं, कैसे उनका अपना खर्चा का किस ढंग से करते हैं और अपना जो सुबह से शाम तक 8 बजे से सुबह और रात को 8 बजे तक या अपने कार्य में व्यस्त रहते हुए भी और फिर अपना टाइम किस तरह निकाल करके, क्योंकि जो भगवद गीता में बताया है कि जो मेरे विषय में चर्चा दूसरों से करता है उससे प्रिय ना कोई हुआ है और ना कोई होगा। तो मैं आपका ज़्यादा समय न लेकर श्री गोविंद प्रभु जी को आपके जो आज स्पीक ऑन द सब्जेक्ट संन्यास आश्रम, तो एक्चुअली वो हिंदी इंग्लिश में बोलेंगे, शायद संभव नहीं हो पाएगा हिंदी में ट्रांसलेशन हो, देखूंगा अगर मैं अंत में थोड़ा सा 5 मिनट में आपको समझी बता।
एंड टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू रीड फ्रॉम द श्रीमद् भागवतम 3rd canto part 4। I will be reading text number 13, 14 and 15. So will everyone repeat after me? Evam swabharana kalpam.
Evam swabharana kalpam.
Tat kalatradayastatha. Nadriyante yatha purvam.
Nadriyante yatha purvam.
Kinasha iva gojaram.
Kinasha iva gojaram.
Tatrapya ajat nirvedo.
Tatrapya ajat nirvedo.
Brihyamana swaya britai.
Brihyamana swaya britai.
Jarayopatta vairupyo.
Jarayopatta vairupyo.
Marana bhimukho grihe.
Marana bhimukho grihe.
Aste avamatya upanyashtam.
Aste avamatya upanyashtam.
Grihapala ivaharan.
Grihapala ivaharan.
Amayavi apradiptagnir.
Amayavi apradiptagnir.
Alpaharo alpacheshtita.
Alpaharo alpacheshtita.
Seeing him unable to support them, his wife and others do not treat him with the same respect as before, even as miserly farmers do not accord the same treatment to their old and worn out oxen. The foolish family man does not become averse to family life, though he is maintained by those whom he once maintained. Deformed by the influence of old age, he prepares himself to meet ultimate death. Thus he remains at home just like a pet dog and eats whatever is so negligently given to him. Afflicted with many illnesses such as dyspepsia and loss of appetite, he eats only very small morsels of food and he becomes an invalid who cannot work anymore. Purport by Srila A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. Not only in the present age, but from time immemorial, no one has liked an old man who is unable to earn in the family. Even in the modern age, in some communities or states, the old men are given poison so that they will die as soon as possible. In some cannibalistic communities, the old grandfather is sportingly killed and a feast is held in which his body is eaten. The example is given that a farmer does not like an old bull who has ceased to work. Similarly, when an attached person in family life becomes old and is unable to earn, he is no longer liked by his wife, sons, daughters and other kinsmen, and he is consequently neglected, what to speak of not being given respect. It is judicious, therefore, to give up family attachment before one attains old age and take shelter of the service of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, so that the Supreme Lord can take charge of him and he will not be neglected by his so-called kinsmen. Family attraction is so strong that even if one is neglected by family members in his old age, he cannot give up family affection and he remains at home just like a dog. In the Vedic way of life, one has to give up family life when he is strong enough. It is advised that before getting too weak and being baffled in material activities and before becoming diseased, one should give up family life and engage oneself completely in the service of the Lord for the remaining days of his life. It is enjoined, therefore, in the Vedic scriptures that as soon as one passes 50 years of age, he must give up family life and live in the forest. And after preparing himself fully, he should become a sannyasi to distribute the knowledge of spiritual life to each and every home. Before meeting death, one is sure to become a diseased invalid. And when he is neglected by his family members, his life becomes less than a dog's because he is put into so many miserable conditions of life. Vedic literatures enjoin, therefore, that before the arrival of such miserable conditions, one should leave home and die without the knowledge of family members. If a man leaves home and dies without his family's knowing, that is considered to be a glorious death. But an attached family man wants his family members to carry him in great procession even after his death. And although he will not be able to see how the procession goes, still he desires that his body be taken gorgeously in procession. Thus he is happy without even knowing where he has to go when he leaves his body for the next life. So please repeat after me. Thus the unfortunate man. Please repeat after me. Seeing him unable. To support them. His wife and others. Do not treat him. With the same respect. As before. Even as miserly farmers. Do not accord the same treatment. To their old. And worn out. Oxen. The foolish family man, does not become averse to family life, although he is maintained, by those whom he once maintained. Deformed by the influence of old age, he prepares himself to meet ultimate death. Thus he remains at home, just like a pet dog, and eats whatever is so negligently given him. Afflicted with many illnesses, such as dyspepsia and loss of appetite, he eats only very small morsels of food, and he becomes an invalid who cannot work anymore. Om Agnyan Timirandasya Jnananjan Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yene Tasmi Shri Guruve Namaha. I was born in the darkest ignorance, and my spiritual master Srila Kirtananand Swami Bhaktipad has opened my eyes with the torchlight of knowledge. Namo Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimade Kirtananda Swami Iti Namine Namaste Sri Bhakti Padaya Prabhupada Priyate Leela Kshetram Paramdham Stapitam Yena Paschimi Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaur Bhaktavinda. Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Ram Hare Ram 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 Hare Hare. So these three verses from the Srimad Bhagavatam actually very typically describe the position of a person who has fulfilled his useful portion of his life, socially useful portion of his life. Actually, everybody lives life in different stages. In the beginning, one is a student. Then one enters household life. In the third stage, one begins semi-retirement from life itself, and the last stage of life is termed to be renounced life. According to the scriptures, the lifespan in Kali Yuga is said to be 100 years of age. And these 100 years of a man's life in Kali Yuga are to be divided into four quarters. From the age 0 to the age 25, one is considered to be living as a student or brahmachari. After the period of brahmacharya is over, you have a period from the age of 25 to the age of 50. And from the age of 25 to the age of 50, this period is known as grihastha ashram. That is the period of household life. The third period of life, which starts from the age of 50 and goes on till the age of 75, is termed as Vanaprastha Ashram. That is, this is the period of life when one lives like a hermit. One is supposed to withdraw from external activities and prepare oneself for the final stage in life, which is known as Sanyas Ashram, which is supposed to begin at the age of 75 years until the end of one's life, which is supposed to be at the age of 100. So here in these four verses, Kapila Dev is describing to his mother the position of a man who is unwilling to leave the second ashram and progress to the remaining two ashrams in life. That life is supposed to be a gradual transition. It is a transition from studenthood to household life, from household life to the life of vanaprastha, and from vanaprastha life to the life of sannyas. And if one does not move from one ashram to the other, then this is a picture of the life of a person who has held on to the second ashram without progressing to future ashrams. So sometimes when people hear this, they get great comfort, because they feel, I heard the lecture, and in the lecture he says I have to take sannyas at the age of 75. So I am very safe. Because who knows whether I live to the age of 75 or not. And since I may not live to the age of 75, I am spared the thought of even wondering what sannyas ashram is like. So I can only repeat the words of my spiritual master, Kirtananand Swami Bhaktipad, who said that although in Kali Yuga one is supposed to live 100 years, because of abuse of our body through our bad habits, most people do not live beyond the age of 70. So he said, therefore all of us should plan our lives so that we should die at the age of 70 and divide our life into four quarters, with 70 being the ultimate stage. That means, he said, that by the age of 35, you should be willing to enter into Vanaprastha Ashram. And that means sannyas comes a lot earlier than you expected. So, before we go into understanding what is Sanyas Ashram, before one jumps into Sanyas Ashram, one should have a clear understanding of what is Sanyas Ashram, what are the obligations of Sanyas Ashram, and what types of sannyasis are there, how should one take sannyas, and what is the behavior of a sannyasi. Now, the Vedic scriptures are very scientifically planned. So scientifically planned means they are planned by God. Actually, the Vedic scriptures are not the utterance of ordinary men. The Vedic scriptures are said to be Shabda Brahma. Shabda Brahma means they are the words of God. So just like if you should go and you should buy a microwave oven or you should buy a television, you will get with it an instruction manual that tells you how to use the microwave oven or the television set. So also when the Lord creates this universe, He gives us an instruction manual on how we should live life. And this instruction manual on how we should live life is said to be the Vedic scriptures. So the Vedic scriptures are the utterance of God. And because the Vedic scriptures are the utterance of God, we must take them with complete and absolute faith, and we should try to model our lives after the Vedic scriptures, because that is the only way we can know peace. It has been said by Lord Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita, Ya shastra vidhim utsrijaya vartate kama karata na sa siddhim avapnoti na sukham na param gatim. One who discards the injunctions of the scriptures and behaves according to his own whims, he knows no peace, he knows no happiness, he knows no perfection, and he does not know the final destination. Therefore, while reading to you the position of a man who has clung on to his family life despite having long crossed the age for leaving family life, I am giving you the picture from the Srimad Bhagavatam of one who has failed to advance from one ashram into another. And this is why I am speaking to you, so that all of us may be aware what are the different ashrams and when we should make the natural transition from one ashram to another. You see, the story that is described in the Srimad Bhagavatam is not simply a story that is given in some dead scripture. These verses actually describe living people. Even today, there are many people who are very perfectly described by these four verses. It is my own friend's father I see when I read this Srimad Bhagavatam. Because his position is exactly the position of this man in the Srimad Bhagavatam. And very often he complains about the position that he has landed in. Why? Because now he is widowed. He is living with his son. And he feels that he is being treated neglectfully. He feels he is living in his own house. But although he is living in his own house and he is the owner of that house, he is treated as if he is nothing but a pet dog. Actually, these are his own words. So when I see this pet dog in this Srimad Bhagavatam, I remember his words. Because when he was very upset one day with his son, I happened to be there. And this is what he spoke. He said, "This is my house, I am living here. You are actually depending upon me for shelter over your roof. But still, in spite of this, I am being treated neglectfully as if I am myself a pet dog living in this house." But this is the natural course of events. When a man is useful, when a man is socially useful, when a man is earning, then everybody respects him. But what happens when a man ceases to earn? Then he ceases to have authority, especially in a materialistic household. Because a materialistic household, emphasis is given not on the person's spiritual caliber or station, but emphasis is given on his productivity of wealth or artha. So therefore, when he is no longer actively producing wealth, then naturally his position in life is brought down. Now, why do people cling on so much to family life? They cling on to family life because of attachment. Now, attachment to what? Attachment to two things. Attachment is attachment to pleasure and attachment to the desire to control. As long as we have the attachment to pleasure, as long as we have the attachment to the desire to control, we can never think of entering into another ashram. Why? We want to enjoy life. You might think, how enjoy life? When you are an old man, how can you enjoy life? So I must share with you a true story that took place not so long ago. You see, every morning when I sit in my balcony, just before I complete finishing the chanting of my rounds, when I open my eyes, I see a very old man walking down the road right in front of my building. My estimate of his age must be that he is at least 85 years old. And being 85 years old, he leans forward because his back is hunched and he leans on a stick. And leaning on the stick, he gradually walks down the road till the end of the road and then he walks back. And sometimes his wife is with him. And his wife is almost as old as he is. And she looks probably older than he does. And every morning I see them walking up and down. One day this man, he came to me when I was entering the building and he said, he said, "You are a doctor, so I want to take some personal advice on a problem that I have." So I said, "Fine, do come over." So he came upstairs with me and then he wanted me to examine him. And I examined him and I told him that he had got a hernia. So I said, "You have a hernia and it's better that you should get it repaired. Nowadays it can be done under local anesthesia, so you can just walk in and walk out. There is no need for you to actually stay in the hospital." But I discovered that in addition to his hernia, he had another problem. And that problem was that he had an enlarged prostate gland. And that enlarged prostate gland gave him great difficulty in passing urine. He told me that, "I have difficulty in getting up to pass urine, and in the night I often have to get up 5-6 times to pass urine. So I am constantly bothered by this problem. So what should I do about it?" I said, "Until this problem is tackled, the hernia should not be touched. So it is better that you get your prostate operated first, and after your prostate is operated, only then we can think about doing something for your hernia." So he said, "Is prostate a very difficult operation? Is it a very complicated operation?" So I said, "No, now any good modern urologist will do it through a transurethral resection. There won't even be a
scar on your body, they will pass a tube up your urethra and they'll take out the prostate from inside, and within 5 days you'll be home. So you don't have to worry about the operation being major or there being any risk to your life. So then he looked at me and he said, Dr. Saab, I want to ask you one personal question. I said, what is that personal question? So he said, I want to ask you, because I have heard from many people, that is it true that after the prostate is removed, your sex life is affected? For a minute I kept quiet because I said, could you repeat what you said? So he said, that is it true that after the prostate gland is removed, your sex life is affected? Fortunately, I was able to keep a straight face. So with great respect, I told him that yes, your sex life is affected, because to some extent, after the prostate operation, there will be some effect to your sex life. So he said, then Dr. Saab, I think that I will not get operated. He says, I think I'll postpone both the operations as long as possible and I will think about it some other time. Thank you very much. So at that time I just thought to myself that here is a man who is 85 years old. His wife cannot be very much younger than him. And still his attachment to enjoyment has not gone. In fact, in the United States of America, what they do to old people is that when they are so old that there is nobody to look after them, because actually in India at least their children look after their parents. In America they put them in an old age home. So the biggest problem in an old age home is keeping the men and women out of each other's bedrooms. This is a major problem that they have. How to keep old men and old women from having illicit sex in the nursing home for the aged. So this is the nature of a person who even in his sunset years has not lost the taste for enjoyment of the flesh. So how can such a person actually know peace? Actually, when I heard this fellow's story and when I examined him and he spoke to me, I remembered the words from the Mohamudgara Stotra. In the Mohamudgara Stotra it has been mentioned, Angam galitam palitam mundam dashanvahinam jatam tundam vriddhoyati grihitva dandam tad apina munjatyasa pindam. That angam galitam, the body has become worn out. Palitam mundam, the hair has gone grey or fallen out. Dashanvahinam jatam tundam, all the teeth have fallen out from the mouth. Vriddho yati grihitva dandam, his spine has also given way, therefore he is leaning on a stick. But he says, tadapi na munjat yasa pindam. But he hasn't given up that bundle of desires. That bundle of desires is still on his back. So he says, bhajagovindam, bhajagovindam, govindam, bhajamudamudam. So, if one does not give up one's attachments according to one's stage in life, then automatically one has difficulties and problems. Because actually, what is ego problem? Ego problem means your false ego is changing all the time. Means one day you're an earning man, one day you're a retired man, one day you're father, one day you're grandfather. But ego problem means that your false ego has changed. That means from father you become grandfather, from working man you become retired man. But you have not been able to adjust your mind or your mentality to your changing false ego. That is the meaning of ego problem. That means your false ego, which is changing, has changed, but you have not been able to mentally adjust to your changing position in life. So precisely that is why God has laid down in the Vedic scriptures that a man must leave his home at a stage in life which is known as Sanyas Ashram. Up till Vanaprastha Ashram, one is allowed to remain in family life to the extent that your wife is permitted to be with you. That in the third stage of life, the wife and the husband, they retire together and they prepare themselves for the last stage of renunciation. And after he has prepared himself for the austerities that must come in the last stage of life of Sanyas Ashram, then he is advised to take Sanyas Ashram. Now what is Sanyas Ashram? Sanyas Ashram means that from now on, from that day onwards, the person is considered to be dead
he is considered to be dead. That person, that identity he had before is no more. Actually, he is supposed to perform at the time of performing, taking sannyas ashram, he is supposed to not only perform the shraddha of his ancestors, but he is supposed to perform his own shraddha. He is supposed to consider that he is dead, that he has been cremated, and after his cremation, food is being offered as shraddha not only to his ancestors but also to himself, because from this moment on he is dead. The clothes he wears are orange colored. Sometimes people ask, what is the meaning of orange? Orange is the color of flame, of fire. When you wear orange colored clothes or clothes which are saffron colored, it means that you have consigned your body and the needs of your body to fire. That means your body is being cremated. That is why you wear orange clothes, to show that the body has been cremated, it has no more value for you. And therefore, considering yourself to be dead, having no connection whatsoever with any previous ashram in life, one is supposed to embark on a completely different stage in life. What do you mean by embark on a different stage in life? He has to have no more connection with his wife. He has to have no more connection with his children. He is to have no more connection with his father or his mother or his brothers or his sisters. He is not to see them, hear of them, or talk to them again. He is even forbidden from even entering the village in which he has lived in the past. And he is not even supposed to travel through the place where he has formerly lived, where he might come across old friends, old acquaintances, or old relatives. From that moment on, that part of his life is over and he is considered to be completely dead. So sannyas ashram is not a light step to be taken. It is a very serious step. And there are different stages of sannyas, and these different stages of sannyas are actually gradations of sannyas from which one can move from one stage to the other until one can perform the final austerities of sannyas ashram. The first stage of sannyas ashram is known as kuti chakra sannyas. Now, what is the meaning of kuti chakra sannyas? Kuti chakra sannyas means that the sannyasi now has no more connection with his family. He no longer meets his family, no longer lives with his family, but he still lives in a house. He still lives in a house. So kuti chakra means one who is a house dweller or one who is a hut dweller. So although he has taken sannyas, he lives in a house. This is usually in the same place or same town or same village where he was living in the past, and he has food either sent to him or prepared for him. That means he is addicted to staying in one home, one house, one place where food is being provided, maybe from his previous family, maybe from other places, but he remains in one place as a kuti chakra sannyasi. The second stage of sannyas is known as bahudaka sannyasi. The bahudaka sannyasi usually does not stay in the place where he was formerly living, his house, village or town. He usually lives in a place of pilgrimage, or he lives at the confluence of holy rivers. And living in a place of pilgrimage or living in a place of where holy rivers meet, he does not live on food that is sent to him from anybody. He lives by what is known as madhukari. That means living like the bee. You know how the bee lives? The bee goes to one flower and takes some honey, then it goes to the second flower and takes some honey, then it goes to the third flower and takes some honey, and collecting a little bit of honey from each place, thereby it makes its meal. So the bahudak sannyasi is one who lives in this way, that although he is living in one place, he moves from one place to the other, and it is recommended that his meal should never be from a single household. His meal should be from at least 3 and possibly 7 houses. That means he should go from 3 to 7 houses, asking for a little bit from each of the houses, and together he should combine this to make his meal. And even this meal that he makes is not supposed to be a lavish or extravagant meal. There are 12 sannyas Upanishads. Out of 108 Upanishads, there are 12 Upanishads which are simply on sannyas. So different Upanishads give different recommendations. Some of them actually recommend that a person who has taken sannyas and who collects food from different houses, how should he collect it? First and foremost, he should never collect food from a house where smoke is coming from the chula. That means nothing should be cooking over there. Everybody in the house should have finished their meal. Not only should everybody in the house should have finished their meal, but all the pots and plates where they eat food should have been turned upside down. That means everybody has eaten their fill. And after everyone has eaten their fill, only then can he approach the household. And even then, he is recommended not to approach the same household again as far as possible. So that he should not become a repeated visitor to ask for food from that household. So this is known as Bahudaka Sannyas. Then we have what is known as House Sannyas, or it is also known as Parivrajakarya Sannyas. And in this form of sannyas, which is known as House Sannyas or Parivrajakarya Sannyas, the sannyasi really begins to do what he has planned to do all the time. Move, move and move. It is said in this Sanyas Upanishad that for the sannyasi there is no coming and for the sannyasi there is no going. Why? Because he is always on the move. So he can never say I am coming, neither can he say he is going, because he is constantly travelling. It is recommended that he should not stay more than 2 nights in the same village, or 3 nights in the same town, or 5 nights in a city. He is not supposed to stay longer than that period in any place. He is supposed to be constantly moving from one place to the other. Why is it recommended that he constantly be moving? So that he forms no attachments. He should not become attached to a place. He should not become attached to followers in a particular place. He should not become attached to any person living in that town or to any position which he might be given in that place. So the sannyasi is constantly on the move, and wherever he moves, he always goes and gives the message of God. Because that is, after all, the mission of the sannyasi, to give the message of God to whomever he meets. This is known as Hamsa or Parivrajakarya Sannyas. Then we come to what is known as Paramhamsa Sannyasi. What is Paramhamsa Sannyasi? The Paramhamsa Sannyasi is that sannyasi who has dropped all rules and regulations. For the Paramhamsa Sannyasi, there are no rules and regulations. He is not obliged to shave his head, neither is he obliged to wear the shikha, neither is he obliged to wear the sacred thread, neither is he required to carry the tridanda. The staff is no longer required for him. The shaven head or the shikha are no longer required for him. It is no longer required that he should wear the sacred thread. And it is only the sannyasi who is a Paramhamsa sannyasi who can give sannyas to other sannyasis. Otherwise, the sannyasis up to this stage are not qualified to give sannyas to others. It is only the Paramhamsa sannyasi who can give sannyas to other sannyasis. Therefore, he is beyond rules and regulations. He has crossed beyond the duality of the world. And having crossed beyond the duality of the world, he is not governed by the rules and regulations of sannyas. And he can travel as he wishes, when he wishes. And he is completely free from all obligations to anyone and to anything. Of course, there are two other classes of sannyasis. But these two other classes of sannyasis are not commonly socially accepted. So, a sannyasi who wants to preach, a sannyasi who desires to preach, does not go beyond the Paramhamsa sannyasi stage. Otherwise, there are two other levels of sannyas in which no preaching occurs whatsoever. And these two levels of sannyas where no preaching occurs at all is, first and foremost, you have what is known as Turiya Atita sannyasi. The Turiya Atita sannyasi is one, from this stage onwards, the sannyasi wears no clothes. He wears no clothes, he does not shave, he lies down in the dirt, he rolls in the filth, he may do anything possible, but he keeps far from human civilization, and all the time he tries to identify himself with the world around him and be aware of non-duality. Lastly, one comes to what is known as Avadhut sannyasi. The Avadhut sannyasi is a one just like the Turiya Atit. But like the Turiya Atit sannyasi, at least he takes food from other people.
and he takes food from other people by madhukari. Of course, the thing is, Turiyati Sannyasi does not use his hands to eat. He eats like the cow. That means when food is placed before him without using his hands, he will bend his head and he will eat from the ground. But the Avadhut Sannyasi is one stage further. Not only like Turiyati Sannyasi does he not preach, but furthermore, he does not even seek anybody to give him food. He follows what is known as Ajagara Vritti. Ajagara Vritti means the life of a python. You know how a python lives? You know, when I was in school, we had a science exhibition. And in the science exhibition, I saw that one student from another school had brought a big python. And it was a huge big python, and he had coiled the python round his neck. And of course, he was the center of attention. So everybody wanted to see the python, touch the python, hold the python. And he let us hold the python. I said, it's a wonderful pet. I would also like to have this pet. But the only problem, I said, is how do you feed this creature? He said, one does not feed the python. So I said, you mean you don't feed this python? What do? He said, I just leave it on the ground. Sometimes it goes for 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks without food. And sometimes a mouse or rat will be running along the road and the mouse or rat may run straight into the python's mouth. And the python will swallow up this mouse and rat, provided the mouse comes to him. Otherwise, he will not pursue the mouse. This is known as Ajagara Vritti. That means the Avadhut Sannyasi lives like a python. If somebody comes and offers food to him, he accepts the food. If nobody offers him food, he accepts it as God's will and he waits for death to come. He is called Avadhut Sannyasi. Not only doesn't preach, he lives like a python. He accepts. If food doesn't come to him, then he is not bothered. He is waiting for death to come to him. But of course, in the Vaishnava tradition, we are not interested in Turiyatit Sannyasi and we are not interested in Avadhut Sannyasis. Because the tradition of the Vaishnava Sannyasi is that the Vaishnava considers everything should be used in the service of God. So that as long as he's got a body, he must use this body in serving God, and the best way to serve God is by preaching his glories and his holy name. So usually in the Vaishnava Sannyas, one does not go beyond Paramahansa Sannyasi because that means renouncing preaching activities. But the rules for sannyas, as I pointed out, are very strict. You can see that they have to perform great austerities. Even the food that they eat is supposed to be not more than 8 mouthfuls. If you fill your mouth 8 times, that's the maximum you can eat. You're not supposed to eat more than filling your mouth 8 times. And furthermore, it is recommended that the sannyasi should fill, just like the yogi, only 2/4 of his stomach with food, 1/4 with water, and 1/4 with air. So this is the kind of food that the sannyasi is supposed to eat. So you can understand that the life of a sannyasi, according to the scriptures, is considered to be very difficult. There are some things expressly forbidden in sannyas. He is not, never in his life is he supposed to live inside a householder's house. He may ask food from the householder, but he is never supposed to actually live with a householder at any time. He should never have connection with any woman in any way of any sort. He is supposed to be perfectly following the principles of celibacy. It has been mentioned that the sannyasi should not let his foot touch a wooden doll in the shape of a woman. So you can understand how strict is the ashram. That even the foot should not touch a wooden doll in the shape of a woman. He is supposed to avoid both wealth as well as wealthy people. Because a householder, a woman and a wealthy person are considered to be poison for the sannyasi because they poison his mentality of sannyas. From the householder, by living in the householder's house, he often is reminded that, oh, I also had a wife like this, I also had children like this, I also had comforts like this. And therefore, he is said to have mentally fallen down. It is known as vantasi. Like a dog who eats his own vomit is said to be vantasi. A sannyasi who after taking sannyas starts thinking that, oh, I also had wife like this, I also had child like this, I also had family like this, is said to be vantasi. Therefore, he is supposed to never live in a householder's house. Secondly, he is supposed to avoid women in all possible ways. Why? Because by association with the opposite sex, even though consciously he may be making an effort to be celibate, the subconscious mind is the deadliest enemy of man. And there are so many vrittis that are stored in the subconscious mind of which the sannyasi himself may not be aware. And these subconscious desires or karma bijas that are there, until they are completely burnt out in spiritual life, there is always a chance that one of them may sprout again. Therefore, there should be no connection with women in any capacity whatsoever, anywhere. Thirdly, he should never have connection with wealthy people, because just like association with the woman will increase lust, association with wealthy persons and association with sources of wealth will increase greed. So these three things are said to be completely forbidden for the sannyasi. So when we hear all these things about sannyas, then we say that, oh, I think we are quite well off as we are. Let us not proceed. Maybe I'll die before I reach sannyas ashram. So this is a common belief in people's minds, that sannyas appears so difficult and so impossible that perhaps it is best that I do not take sannyas ashram. Because sannyas ashram is not meant for everybody. Actually, according to the Vedic scriptures, it is only the Brahmin who takes sannyas. It is only the Brahmin who takes sannyas. What do I mean by Brahmin? By Brahmin, I do not necessarily mean one who has been born in a Brahmin's family, although he may be born in a Brahmin's family. What I mean by Brahmin is that guna karma vibhagasha, he should have the qualities of a Brahmin and he should be performing the activities of a Brahmin. What are the qualities of a Brahmin? Sama dama tapa saucham shantir arjavam evacha jnayam vijnanam ashtikyam brahma karma swabhavajam. Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita that the qualities of a Brahmin are such that he is sama, he is peaceful, dama, he is self-controlled, tapa, he is capable of performing austerities, saucham, he is pure, shantir, he is tolerant, if people abuse him or mistreat him, he can tolerate it, arjavam, he is straightforward, he can tell the truth even to an enemy, even if it is to his disadvantage, jnanam, he must possess knowledge about scripture and about God, vijnanam, he should possess not only knowledge but realization, ashtikyam, he should be religiously inclined. So one who has guna, these gunas, these qualities present within him, and karma, who is performing the activities of a Brahmin. What are the activities of a Brahmin? The activities of a Brahmin are, one, that he performs sacrifice, and two, he teaches others to perform sacrifice. What is the best sacrifice? Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, yagnanam japo yagnosmi. The best sacrifice is the sacrifice of the chanting of the holy name. So not only he chants the holy names, but he teaches others how to chant the holy names. He studies the scripture for his own benefit and he imparts the knowledge from the scripture to others. That not only he reads the scripture, but he imparts knowledge from the scriptures to another. And thirdly, he accepts charity, and this charity that he accepts, he gives in charity. So these are the three activities of the Brahmin. So one who has got these qualities or gunas and one who has performed, who performs these activities of the Brahmana, only such a person is qualified to go in for sannyas, because it is not recommended for people who do not have these qualities and who do not perform these activities. One who's got the qualities of Kshatriya is not supposed to move beyond Vanaprastha stage. Whereas the Shudras and the Vaishyas are supposed to remain in Grihastha Ashram. Not even Vanaprastha stage is recommended for them. Therefore, one should think 100 times before one thinks about taking sannyas. Because sannyas is not an easy task to take up. It is a task which is greatly difficult and which has tremendous demands on a person. In fact, it has been even stated in the scripture that in Kali Yuga, sannyas according to these rules and regulations is impossible. That according to the rules and regulations that I have mentioned, sannyas in Kali Yuga is impossible and should never be performed. It is said, Ashwamedham Golambam Sanyasam Palapaitrakam Devarena Sutotpatim Kalau Pancham Vivarjayet. That these five things are forbidden in Kali Yuga. What are the things that are forbidden in Kali Yuga? Ashwamedham, sacrifice of the horse. Gavalambam, sacrifice of the cow. Sanyas, taking of sanyas. Offering meat at Shraddha ceremony and marrying your brother's widow. Devarena Sutotpatim. So these activities are said to be forbidden in Kali Yuga because it is not possible for the average person in Kali Yuga to perform these activities. It has been said that Kalau Shudra Sambhava. That in Kali Yuga, everybody is untrained in spiritual life. So because people are untrained in spiritual life, sannyas ashram becomes an impossibility for such people. I remember speaking to my spiritual master Kirtananda Swami Bhaktipad. And when I spoke to him, I said that Bhaktipad, in this Hare Krishna movement, the statistics show that 50% of sannyasis fall from sannyas ashram. Please note the statistics. That 50% of sannyasis who take sannyas, they fall down from that ashram of sannyas and they go back to their old ways. They get married or they take to household life again, and most of them, because of the shame, they quit association with previous devotees forever. That means they are lost to spiritual life. Of course, even if one falls from sannyas ashram, one should not consider that person to be fallen. In the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says very clearly, Api chet sudracharo bhajate mam ananya bhak sadhu revas amantavya samyag vyavasitav hisa shipram bhavati dharmatma shashvat shantim nigachyati kaunteya pratijanahi name bhaktya pranashyati. So Krishna actually says in the Bhagavad Gita that even if a person is said to fall from sannyas ashram or perform other abominable acts, you should not consider him to be anything other than a sadhu. Why? Because he is rightly situated as long as he is worshipping me. And as long as he continues to worship me with great intensity and faith, he says, very soon this person shall become perfect and shall know everlasting peace. Because he says, O son of Kunti, declare it boldly, my devotee shall never perish. So, I asked Srila Bhaktipad that 50% of sannyasis fall down. What is the reason for this? It's almost approaching the statistic for American marriages. In America, if you get married, the statistic is that you have greater than 50% chances that your marriage will break up. So I said that is similar to the statistic for taking sannyas. That if you take sannyas, there's more than 50% chance that you're likely to go back to your previous ashram. So then why should one take this opportunity at all? Why should one think of taking sannyas ashram in an age which is known as Kali Yuga, where actually sannyas ashram is forbidden? So then my spiritual master Kirtanan Swami actually explained to me. He said that the ability to enter into another ashram depends upon how you've lived the previous ashram. If you have not lived the previous ashram perfectly, then there is no question of your advancing to the higher ashram. For example, a man who has not lived properly in Brahmachari ashram, he has not lived properly like a Brahmachari. That means even in his student days, he has been anything but Brahmachari. How can this man become Grihastha? He can never be satisfied with one wife. He will always be looking for some other woman. Therefore, one who is a failure in Brahmachari ashram, he can never enter properly into Grihastha ashram. So also,
One who has not lived Grihastha Ashram properly. How do you live Grihastha Ashram properly? That's the subject of another lecture, which if you want, you can get the cassette from the library or I may give it at some other time. But Grihastha Ashram also means, Bhaktipada explained, that you should live a God-conscious life as a householder. That you should perform sacrifice in household life. And that you should gradually advance from this ashram to the next ashram. That is Vanaprastha Ashram. And only one who has lived Grihastha life fully, understanding that God is the source of everything, can advance to Vanaprastha Ashram. And only one who has lived in Vanaprastha Ashram properly can advance to Sanyas Ashram. Therefore, actually, if you see, in the tradition of the Gaudiya Vaishnavas, Sanyas is practically unknown. Sanyas is practically unknown in the tradition of the Gaudiya Vaishnavas. It is true that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu took Sanyas. But why did Chaitanya Mahaprabhu take Sanyas? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu took Sanyas for one specific purpose. One day, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was sitting in his court and he was chanting on the beads the name of the different gopis. So when he was chanting loudly the name of the different gopis, some students from a nearby pathshala came and they began laughing and mocking him, thinking that he was lustily taking the name of women. And Chaitanya became so enraged that he chased them. And then when he went back, he thought that people are laughing at me and they are mocking me in this way because I am living the life of a householder. But if I take Sanyas Ashram, then people will respect me and they will listen to the message that I give about God more seriously. So what is the reason for taking Sanyas Ashram? The reason for taking Sanyas Ashram is not to become liberated. Because liberation is available in all ashrams. Actually, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself has said in his talks with Ramanand Rai that everyone can continue to remain in that position in life in which he is situated. Whatever varna, whatever ashram is situated, let him continue to live in that varna and ashram. But simply let him associate with saintly people. And by associating with saintly people, hearing the glories of God, they will achieve the goal of life, that is to attain love of God. So when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself felt that it is not necessary to change your varna or ashram to achieve love of God, why did he himself take sannyas? He took the position of a sannyasi because it was an effective vehicle for preaching his message. Therefore, sannyas was taken by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu for the sake of preaching the message of Lord Krishna. Actually, A.C. Bhakti Vedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada was very much against sannyas ashram. When he formed the League of Devotees, after which we are now following, when he formed the League of Devotees in Jhansi, he made it clear on paper that in this League of Devotees, I am not interested in sannyasis. This League of Devotees should be conducted by the Grihasthas and the Vanaprasthas. There is actually no need for any sannyasi or requirement for sannyasi in preaching this message. And he himself said that sannyas ashram requires so many austerities and so many difficulties in following the rules and regulations that I feel that I myself will never be able to follow these rules and regulations. Then why did Prabhupada take sannyas? Why did Abhay Charan De become A.C. Bhakti Vedanta Swami? He became A.C. Bhakti Vedanta Swami on the encouragement of his god brother, who told him that you have preached for more than 50 years. You have been a devotee for more than 50 years. You have spent a lifetime in preparation, but no one has listened to your message. Why? He says, because unless you take to sannyas and unless you become A.C. Bhakti Vedanta Swami, no one will hear what you have to say. So Prabhupada says that I pray to Lord Krishna. Prabhupada writes, that I pray to Lord Krishna
And I pray to Lord Krishna that the difficulties of sannyas ashram are great. They require great austerities, great hardships and so many regulations that I will never be able to follow them like I see my god brothers following. I will never be able to come to that standard. And Prabhupada said that Krishna spoke to me and Krishna said, don't worry. All you have to do is to keep preaching my message. And as long as you continue to preach my message, you will not have to worry about maintaining your position of sannyas. I will see that everything will go smoothly. And on this assurance that Krishna gave Prabhupada, he took sannyas simply so that his message that he was preaching would be received much better with greater respect. So also my spiritual master, Kirtananda Swami Bhaktipad, when he was brought to Vrindavan by his Guru Maharaj, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami, Prabhupada asked my spiritual master that you are a young man, hardly 27, 28 years old. Are you willing to forever give up all thoughts of sex life for my sake? Although you are young, although you have been brought up in the West, although you have been brought up in a different culture, although you have different sanskars within you, for my sake, are you willing to give up all thoughts of sex life from now on? And unhesitatingly, Kirtananand answered, yes, I will. And he offered obeisances at the feet of A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. And my spiritual master says that when he got up from offering obeisances and looked at his spiritual master, he found that Prabhupada had tears in his eyes. He had tears in his eyes when he saw that his disciple, out of love, was willing to give up all thoughts of sex life from that period on and take sannyas. And Kirtananand became Kirtananand Swami. And he became the first American sannyasi to be given sannyas in the Vaishnava order. And this is why he took sannyas, on the instruction of his spiritual master, because his spiritual master wanted him to take sannyas because this would assist the spread of the message of Lord Krishna. It is not taking to an ashram simply because the previous ashram is uncomfortable. It is not taking to an ashram simply because you seek liberation. It is not taking an ashram because you want to advance in spiritual life. It is taking sannyas ashram so that the message of Lord Krishna can be given to others and they will be able to receive it with greater respect and with greater receptivity. So sannyas ashram may not be for all of us, because it is said that many are called, but few are chosen. See, God calls many people, but He chooses very few for the difficult tasks, because He knows that only few can perform the tasks that are required. Only few are willing to make that complete surrender that is required for preaching His glories. Therefore, many are called, but few are chosen. Therefore, it may not be within everybody's life to take sannyas, at least in this life. Therefore, it is recommended that although we may not enter into sannyas ashram externally, we must necessarily at least enter into sannyas ashram internally. This is an important point that I would like to make, that although sannyas ashram is an ashram that is one of the last ashrams of spiritual life, it is very difficult to follow externally the requirements for this sannyas. And only a few who can dedicate their lives to preaching the message and who are chosen by their spiritual master to become sannyasis can take sannyas. But what is possible for all of us is that we can all become sannyasis internally. Actually, everybody lives in two worlds. We live in an external world, which is a world of name, form, appearance, where people judge you. And there is an internal world in which we live, the world of our thoughts, the world of our consciousness, the world of the heart. And this it is the internal world that the Lord looks upon. And in the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna actually discourages people from taking this fourth ashram. He says very clearly to Arjuna, Sanyasastu Mahabhao Dukham Aptuma Yogata. That if you should take sannyas without being situated on the platform of God realization, you will get only misery. Sanyasastu Mahabhao Dukham Aptuma Yogatam. Dukham, you will get only unhappiness. Therefore, he says, Yoga Yukta Munir Brahma Na Chirena Adigachati. But one who continues to work with devotion, he also attains the Supreme without delay. Therefore, we should not think that if we do not take the fourth ashram in life, we shall not achieve the goal of life, achieve love of God. And those who are aspiring for liberation should not think that liberation is not possible. It is very clear that all of us in our lifetimes, regardless of the ashram that we are situated in, can achieve love of God. But we should not unnecessarily try to change our ashram simply out of whimsy. A change in ashram is made only upon the direct request of the spiritual master. Because the spiritual master is the doctor, we are his patient. And the spiritual master judges and sees whether we are fit for another ashram or not. He is the schoolmaster who decides whether the student should be promoted to another class or whether they should remain in the same class. And we should be aware that even if we are living as householders, even if we remain brahmacharis all our lives, even if we remain vanaprasthas all our lives, we should know that love of God is easily accessible to everybody. Because in Kali Yuga, God is easily accessible in His holy name. Harer Naam, Harer Naam, Harer Naam Eva Kevalam. Kalau Nasti Eva Nasti Eva Nasti Eva Gatir Anyatha. There is no other way, there is no other way, there is no other way to achieve love of God other than by chanting the holy name, chanting the holy name, chanting the holy name. Because it is by chanting the holy name that we develop love of God. And we can become sannyasis by listening to the words of Lord Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita. In the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says, Anashrita karma phalam karya karma karotu ya. Sa sannyasi cha yogi cha na niragnir na chakriya. That one who works as he is obligated, without taking the shelter of the fruits of his labor, he is the true sannyasi, he is the true yogi, not one who lights no fire and does no work. So if you continue to work in your field, wherever you are situated, but you do not take shelter of the fruits of your labor, what do I mean by not taking the shelter of the fruits of your labor? I mean that you should not gratify your senses. Even if you are making 100 crore rupees every month, live an austere life, sleep on the floor, eat only to maintain your body. Do not spend your time watching cinema, video, reading foolish magazines, going to cocktail parties. Live the life of a person who has given up sense pleasures and has dedicated his life to God. And if you do that, if you can do that, if you can live your life as you are supposed to do every duty that is required of you, and in addition to doing your duty, you are able to give up sense gratificatory activity. That means eating well, unnecessarily well, dressing unnecessarily well, talking unnecessarily about mundane activities, and associating unnecessarily with materialistically minded people, you can be a sannyasi living in the ashram in which you are presently situated. Krishna says, Yam sannyasam iti prahur, yogam tam vidhi pandava, na hi asanyashta sankalpo yogi bhavati kashchana. That no one can become a sannyasi or a yogi unless he has given up all desires for sense gratification. Therefore, it is our beholden duty that however we may live our life, whether we are living a life with wife, family and children, or whether we live as single boys or single women, as brahmacharis or brahmacharinis, it is our duty that we should increase our attachment to God and decrease our attachment for the world. And by decreasing our attachment for the world, I do not mean the work or duties that you have in the world. It is decreasing your attachment to the pleasures of the world. So the duties and work that you have to do, you do that with love and devotion. But the pleasures and the enjoyments of the world, you must gradually give up. If you can give them up suddenly, that is best. But if you can't give these pleasures up suddenly, then at least you must gradually give up the pleasures of the world. And you must fill in these activities of sense gratification by activities of God consciousness. If you like to eat wonderful food, eat food that has been offered to God with love and devotion. If you must be surrounded by friends, make sure that you seek out satsang. If you must have intoxication, become intoxicated by chanting the holy name of God. But do not falsely seek pleasures of the world where other people seek their pleasures. Because in seeking the pleasures of the world, you will be lost from the ideal that Krishna is talking about. Many people say, I am Karma Yogi. I am a Karma Yogi. I am following Bhagavad Gita. I am working very hard and therefore I am following Krishna's instructions. But in the evening when he comes home, he has a bottle of beer, his legs go up and he sits and watches Chaya Gita, the Hindi movie and television. That is not Karma Yogi. A Karma Yogi is one who works as he is obligated, and when he comes home, he spends his life chanting the holy name of God, associating with the devotees, reading the Bhagavad Gita and the Srimad Bhagavatam, living a life of austerity, sleeping on the floor, minimizing his food to what is exactly necessary and no more, avoiding association of materialistic people simply for pleasure and enjoyment. Such a person is a Karma Yogi. Not the person who works hard, comes home and enjoys hard. It's not just work, work, work and enjoy, enjoy, enjoy. It is work, work, work and detach, detach, detach. That while you work, put your heart, your mind and your soul in it by performing it with love and devotion for God. But when you come home, utilize the time you have to increase your attachment to God as much as possible within the means that are available to you. Make your house a temple of the Lord. Engage your wife and your children in service to the Lord. And all the time become aware that nothing belongs to you, everything belongs to the Lord. Because true sannyas is not a change of dress, it is a change of mentality. True sannyas is not a change of dress, it is a change of mentality. A change of dress may be performed by some when it is necessary for the sake of preaching. But a change of mentality is required by every single one of you. It is required by every single one of you simply because it is necessary for your survival. If you want to survive in the world, in peace, in happiness, in bliss, then you have no choice but to be a sannyasi mentally. And if you live like this, you will become detached. The Bhagavatam very clearly says that Vasudeva Bhagavati Bhakti Yoga Prayojita Janayati Ashu Vairagyam Jnanam Cha Yad Ahaitukam. That if you follow the principles of Bhakti Yoga under a spiritual master, then if you follow the instructions perfectly without making any separate effort or endeavor, automatically you will realize that you are acquiring spiritual knowledge and that you are becoming detached from the world.
That you may live in your home, but you will know, this is not my husband, this is not my wife. I am just a passenger. I am a passing ship. And I am here for the moment, but tomorrow the Lord will take all these things from me. Therefore, as long as they are here, out of love for God, I must treat them with the respect that God would want me to offer them. But in time to come, I should understand these do not belong to me and they shall be parted from me. You should be mentally unattached while being physically performing your duty. Actually, the law of life is that the body should remain constantly in activity and the mind should remain constantly at rest. Where at rest? It should rest at the lotus feet of God. Savaya mana Krishna padaravindayor. That the body is always in activity, but the mind always rests at the feet of God. But unfortunately, very often we find that the body is always at rest and the mind is constantly in activity. That is in direct contrast with what Krishna wants us to do. Krishna wants us to be active in the world. He wants us to work in the world. He wants us to work with love and devotion. And He wants our mind to be at rest. He wants our mind to rest at His feet. He wants us to keep our hopes, our ambitions, our anxieties, our fears, our delusions. All these things He wants us to keep it at His feet. He wants us to surrender all our delusions, our tendencies, our vasanas, our sanchit karmas. He wants us to surrender it at His feet. All our conceptions of God, of ritualism, of formalism, all these things He wants us to rest at His feet. Therefore, Krishna says, Sarva dharman parityaja mam ekam sharanam raja aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami masucha. Abandon all varieties of religion and surrender to me. I will relieve you from all sinful activity. Do not fear. Many people quote this verse. Sarva dharman parityaja mam ekam sharanam raja aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami masucha. That means all of you, now go home, shave your heads, wear a sannyasi's robes, carry the tridanda and hit the road. That's what Krishna is telling you. Sarva dharman parityaja, abandon everything and surrender to me. So shave your head, wear your robes, take your tridanda and hit the street. But that is not what Krishna says, because we must see this verse in reference to context. If that was what he meant, then Arjuna with great joy would have jumped off from his chariot and visited the local barber and changed his clothes and started out for Himalayas. That is not what he told Arjuna. He told Arjuna that you surrender your mind to me. Surrender everything mentally to me and externally you continue to do what you are expected to do at this moment. So he makes Arjun a sannyasi. And Arjun is a sannyasi on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. He gives up all thoughts, all attachments, all desires, all fears, all delusions, all hopes, all ambitions, all desires for royal happiness. And he fights on the battlefield of Kurukshetra simply because it will please the Lord. So Arjun in the Bhagavad Gita is in the process of transformation from a prince into a sannyasi, but there is no change in his dress. So also, this is what Krishna expects from all of us. He wants every single one of us to be a sannyasi. But he doesn't want all of us to be sannyasis in the traditional sannyas ashram. He wants all of us to be sannyasis as he made Arjun a sannyasi. He wants us to be sannyasis like Arjun. He wants us to continue wearing the same clothes, continue in the same ashram, continue in the same duties. But with an attitude of renunciation. An internal mental attitude of renunciation that God, everything I do is for you. You can make it successful. You can make it a failure. And whatever results or whatever fruits come to me, that also belongs to you. Therefore, in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna very clearly says that towards the end of the Bhagavad Gita, he says that true sannyas
is actually an attitude of complete detachment. That when one is completely detached from things of the world, only then can one consider oneself to be sannyasi. So sannyas actually means an internal mental renunciation of the world and externally continuing to do one's duty, even though externally to the people who are watching you, you may appear to be very attached. Actually, there's a verse in the, I think it's in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, which says, Iha yasya harer dasya karmanasa manasa gira nikhilashva api avasthasu jivan mukta sa uchyate. That externally when you look at a man, you may think that, oh, he's working in the world like anybody else. He's working hard just like you and me. But internally that person is a sannyasi because he has given up all attachments, all feelings of possessiveness and all desires for enjoyment. And being in this mental state of sannyas, he is considered to be jivan mukta. He is considered to be liberated even in this life. So if all of you, you take a vow today that from this day on you will decide that you will become sannyasi. Actually, I came with 4 young gentlemen in the car today and all of them left their wives at home. And all of them told their wives that today we are going to attend Sri Govind's lecture on Sanyas Ashram. So all the wives became very seriously disturbed. They thought that their husbands may take sannyas at the lecture itself and not come back home. So people are always afraid of Sanyas Ashram. But I want all of them to be sannyasis. I want all of you to be sannyasis. But what kind of sannyas do I want you to take? I want you to take a vow in front of Krishna right now that you will be sannyasis. But what kind of sannyasis? Sannyasis, the same type of sannyasi that Arjun was. Externally, looking at him from a worldly point of view, he appeared to be functioning in the world like anybody else. But internally, he was as much sannyasi as anyone else. Because what is the use of changing your dress if you haven't changed your internal attitude? It has been said, Jatilo mundi lunchita kesha kashaya ambara bahukrita vesha pashyanapi na pashyati mudo udara nimittam bahukrita vesha bhajagovindam govindam bhaja mudamate. He says, Jatilo mundi, they have matted locks on their hair. Lunchita kesha, they shave their heads or they have plucked their hair. Kashaya ambar, they wear orange robes. But he says, Pashyanapi na pashyati mudo, they don't see Krishna anywhere. Why? Because udara nimittam bahukrita vesha, they have simply taken that dress to feed their belly. For filling their belly, they have taken to this profession of sannyas. So there are many sannyasis who take to this profession externally without internally becoming sannyasi. So I don't want you to become like that. It is necessary for you to become internally sannyasi while externally remaining what in whatever position in life you are. That means today you take a vow that you will continue to work in life exactly as you have been doing all the time, but one, you will cease sense gratificatory activities that have no connection to Krishna. You will simplify your life and you will minimize the normal pleasures. People tell me, "Arey, after your lecture, now you want us to stop normal pleasures like watching Chaya Geet and reading magazines and novels." But I have to tell them, these are not normal pleasures, these are abnormal pleasures. In fact, they are not pleasures. Because in the beginning they seem pleasurable, but later they are the cause of pain. Therefore, I want you to take to normal pleasures. What is normal pleasure? Give up what normal people consider pleasures and simplify your lifestyle. Minimize the pleasures of eating, sleeping, mating, defending. Work hard as you are obligated. Spend your time in chanting the name of God, associating with devotees of God, hearing the message of God, reading the message of God. And in this way, by giving up the desire for enjoyment and control, and yet living in your life, performing your duties to your best abilities, you can continue to live as a sannyasi from today onwards. So this is my humble request to all of you, that all of you should mentally make a vow today that yes, today after learning what is sannyasashram, I shall try to be a sannyasi like Arjun. I will try to do my job and my duties perfectly, but simultaneously I shall deny myself everything. It is said that at the taking of sannyasashram, you perform your own shraddha. It's like your own funeral, and you feed yourself the remnants of Narayan Prasad. Therefore, that means you consider yourself to be dead. Therefore, all of you should consider yourselves, if you take this vow of mental sannyas, of internal sannyas, today you take the vow that from today onwards, I am dead. I, whatever your name is, from today I am dead. I do not live, nothing exists for my pleasure anymore, because I do not exist anymore. This is my death today. And from now on, I shall live only for law for the Lord. My life from now on is dedicated only to Krishna. And by considering myself dead, I shall now learn how to live. Because unless you learn to die, you cannot live. So sannyas means dying so that you can live. So if you learn to die to the pleasures of the world, only then you can live in the service of the Lord. So this is the message that I have come to give you, and I hope that all of you will take this message seriously. Thank you so much. Are there any questions on what I have spoken of today?
First of all, in 2 minutes, मैं आपको मैं जो लोग सिर्फ हिंदी स्पीकिंग है उनको बताना जरूरी है कि श्री गोविंद जी ने आज बताया कि वैसे संन्यास की बहुत से तरीके बताए लेकिन अंत में ये बताया कि कलयुग में संन्यास बताया नहीं है लेकिन प्रीचिंग के लिए भगवान का जो मैसेज सबको देने के लिए भगवान का ज्ञान लोगों को बताने के लिए अगर गुरु की आदेश होता हो तो उसके आदेश के आधार पर जैसे कि श्री लखुबाज जी ने भक्तिपाद के लिए कहा कि आप संन्यास लीजिए और अपनी सेक्स लाइफ को कम्प्लीटली छोड़ दीजिएगा और ये भगवान की मैसेज सारे संसार में दीजिए तो गुरु के आदेश के अनुसार उसको संन्यास लिया जा सकता है चैतन्य महाप्रभु ने उसी लिए ये संन्यास लिया दूसरी बात श्री गोविंद जी ने जो खास बताई कि लोग ये कहें कि भाई हम अपना कार्य कर रहे हैं लेकिन कार्य कर रहे हैं कर्म कर रहे हैं क्योंकि आज सारे संसार में कर्म के बारे में लोग बहुत बोलते हैं कि ठीक है इन्होंने हमको बता दिया हम अपना कर्म कर रहे हैं और यही हमारा संन्यास है ज्यादातर लोग ये इसी चीज की डिफेंस लेते हैं कि भाई हम अपना कार्य कर रहे हैं और हम फैमिली को पाल रहे हैं और इस तरह से अपना कार्य करा रहे हैं लेकिन उनके साथ में जो दूसरा शब्द उन्होंने बोला है कि जो कार्य अपना कर रहे हैं लेकिन अगर वो सोचते हैं कि दिन भर काम करके और अगर हम शाम के टाइम पर घर पर आ जाते हैं और एक बोतल लेकर के पीने बैठ जाते हैं और एक लंबी टांगे टक्के करके टेलीविजन देखने लग जाते हैं और सारे उल्टे सीधे करते हैं तो वो सन्यासी नहीं है उनकी गिनती सन्यासी में नहीं आती वो फिर उनकी गिनती उन लोगों में आती है जैसे कि उन्होंने पहले उदाहरण दिया था 85 इयर्स ओल्ड होने के बाद भी बुढ़े और बुढ़ी वो जब ऑपरेशन के लिए उनके पास आए अरे तो हम ऑपरेशन नहीं कराएंगे क्योंकि अगर हमारी फिर तो सेक्स डिजायर कम हो जाएगी तो इस तरह से अंत में श्री गोविंद जी ने बताया कि भगवत गीता का सार भगवत गीता के 18वें अध्याय के 66वें श्लोक में है जिसमें कि भगवान कहते हैं कि सर्व धर्मों को छोड़कर एकमात्र शरण मेरी शरण में जाओ इस सब धर्मों को छोड़कर एकमात्र मेरी शरण में आने का मतलब ये नहीं है उन्होंने बताया कि आप सब कुछ छोड़ करके भगवान कृष्ण ने ये नहीं बोला था अर्जुन को कि तुम आओ और नहीं तो वो अपना सिर मुड़ा करके और सीधा जंगल में चले जाते लेकिन ऐसा नहीं बताया उन्होंने बताया कि जो मैं तुमको जो कार्य तुम कर रहे हो तुम अपने विचारों को छोड़ करके और मेरी विचारों को जो मैं कह रहा हूँ वो करो मतलब अपनी भावना को चेंज करो जो भावना को व्यक्ति बदल देगा तो फिर अपने कर्मों को बदलने की कार्य करने की उसको बदलने की जरूरत नहीं है और ये अपने
And हाँ और बहुत सबसे बड़ी जो खास बात है क्योंकि एक सवा घंटे का लेक्चर दो मिनट में is impossible लेकिन सबसे बड़ी चीज़ है कि हम अपने हम जो detachment का मतलब यह है कि हम अपनी इंद्रियों को तृप्ति करने का जो जो हमारी इच्छा है अगर उसको हम खत्म कर दें तो आप सन्यासी हैं नहीं तो जो कार्य आप कर रहे हैं अगर उसमें आप इंद्रिय तृप्ति की भावना को खत्म नहीं कर सकते उसके जो दो बताए एक्सटर्नल और इंटरनल जो वो एक्सटर्नल चीज तो आप दुनिया के लिए करते हैं लेकिन जो इंटरनल अगर आप मन के अंदर जो सोच लें एक बार कि मैं भगवान को कैसे प्रसन्न कर सकता हूँ जैसे उन्होंने बताया कि जमीन पर सोना सादा खाना खाना और अपने भगवान से संबंधित लोगों से संबंध रखना या इस तरह से भगवान की चर्चा करना इन चीजों से जो है हम वास्तव में चाहे जैसी आश्रम में रहें हम सन्यासी कहलाएंगे लेकिन अब एक प्रश्न मेरा आता है सबसे पहले बिफोर एनीबॉडी आस्क क्वेश्चन कि आपने जब ये कहा व्हेन यू सेड इट कि अंटिल अनलेस वन हैज लिव्ड लाइक ए ट्रू ब्रह्मचारी और ही हैज नॉट लिव्ड लाइक ए ट्रू ब्रह्मचारी और ही हैज नॉट लिव्ड लाइक ए ट्रू गृहस्थ देन हाउ यू कैन एक्सपेक्ट एनीबॉडी टू बिकम a good person in the society at this time, whether it is sannyas, he is sannyasi or anybody. Because you can't, we have not been trained at all to become a good brahmachari or good sannyasi, a good grastha. So there is no chance, there is no hope at all so that we can become detached people. That because you have said it in the beginning.
In the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says very clearly, he says, तद्विधि प्रणिपातेन परिप्रश्नेन सेवया उपदेक्षान्ति ते ज्ञानं ज्ञानिनस तत्वदर्शनम् He says, yes, there is no way that you can become spiritually realized by yourself. Therefore, Krishna is telling Arjun, seek out a spiritual master. Humbly serve him. Surrender unto him. Ask questions to him. And he can show you the truth because he has seen it. Therefore, while it is correct that by ourselves, because we have not lived Brahmachari ashram properly and we are not living Grihastha ashram properly, what is the chance of our becoming spiritually realized? Zero. Our chance is zero. What is the chance of making spiritual progress? Zero. Therefore, the only way to make spiritual progress is by seeking out a saintly person and taking guidance and instruction from him and becoming his disciple. This is what Krishna says very clearly. It's also been said in the Srimad Bhagavatam. It has been said, Tasmad gurum prapadyet jignashu shreya uttamam shabde pare nishnatam brahmani upashamashriyam. Therefore, all those who are seriously desirous of lasting happiness and spiritual progress must seek out a spiritual master, learned in knowledge and realized in wisdom, who is capable of convincing you through argument and logic of the purport of the scripture. Therefore, you can spend 100 years in spiritual life. You can keep on coming for satsang. You can become a congregation member for 50 years. But you will never make spiritual progress until you surrender to a spiritual master seriously. I don't mean through an external ceremony only, but through internal surrender also. Because there are so many people who take external diksha and then they become lost. It is necessary that there should be an internal surrender to the spiritual master in following out his message. Because by following his message, only then can we become spiritually realized. Does it answer your question?
Very nice. One car is
starting. In my course.
Yeah. I think it requires lamba. Iska jawab chahiye.
See, starting on Monday, that is starting this Monday on 24th, I am conducting a 7-day course on the essence of Bhagavad Gita where common questions like this will be answered. So those of you who have not attended my course on the essence of Bhagavad Gita are strongly advised to attend this course because I assure you that 95% of all such questions will be answered. Any questions on today's subject? Yes.
You have said that you have said that in telling you Brahmacharya is not there or is not advisable. It is not there.
Yes.
Sanyas, Sanyas. Secondly, you gave a lot of references from Bhagavad Gita, and the Lord Himself has said that Sanyas There is a lot of pain in sannyas, and sannyas is not required. To get liberated also, sannyas is not required. And you have given so many examples that sannyas is not required. You know, you should be eternally detached and sannyas is not required. But, in spite of all this, you know, Lord's order, why you have given more order in the hands of Guru, that Guru will have to, you know, Guru should say, you know, take sannyas and you will become sannyas. So this is, you know, that means Guru is more than your Lord.
So for those of you who haven't understood his question is that Krishna says in the, recommends in the that you should not take sannyas. And yet I am saying that if Guru says to take sannyas, you should take sannyas. So are you placing Guru higher than God? Actually, Guru is never God. Guru is the representative of God. Guru is simply the means through which we see God. Just like a man who has got poor vision will require spectacles to see clearly, all of us require Guru in order to see God clearly. So Guru is the medium who helps us to see God. Guru is not God. But we have to make out that there is a difference between Bhagavad Gita and given instruction given by Krishna in Bhagavad Gita and instruction given by Guru to disciple. Bhagavad Gita instruction is meant as a general instruction, a general recommendation. The Guru's recommendation or instruction is specific. The Guru's recommendation is specific for that particular person at that particular time, at that particular place. So if you think that Bhagavad Gita is enough, you will never make any spiritual progress. Because Bhagavad Gita is giving general instructions which according to your present circumstances may not be entirely suitable. Therefore, we require not only Bhagavad Gita, but we require a representative of Lord Krishna who with divine intelligence can individually take your case and decide what you should be doing. So while Bhagavad Gita gives general instruction, Guru gives you specific instruction for yourself. This is why people try to avoid taking Guru. Why? No, I am following Bhagavad Gita. I am following Bhagavatam, no problem. Who wants Guru? Why? Because if Guru comes and tells you something uncomfortable, then what will you do? So I am leading peaceful life. I can take out from Bhagavad Gita whatever shloka I want. It is said, you know, different shlokas for different folks. So you can always find something in the scripture that agrees with your point of view. So that's why people who are like this, who are looking different shlokas for different folks, they live a very comfortable material life, but spiritually they get zero, they get anda, zilch. They get nothing because they take out from the scripture exactly what pleases them. That is the nature of the mind. So in order to surrender the mind, in order to tame the mind, in order to control the mind, in order to annihilate the material mind, it is necessary to seek out a spiritual master who is a living embodiment of the spiritual guru, original spiritual master, Lord Krishna. And surrender your mind at his lotus feet. And by surrendering your mind at his lotus feet, then you can make spiritual progress. Does it answer your question?
So, actually, I may add one word here. Guru can spread the message of Krishna. Guru can give instruction because Krishna says in Gita, I am very much pleased anybody who is spreading my message to other people. So Guru is making arrangement when he sees somebody that this man is potent enough who can spread the message of God. So he can ask that man, now you do this work. So Krishna is also pleased. That's the way Krishna, Guru wants to please Krishna. And that's maybe another. So now I would like to tell you, Sri Govind Prabhu ke lecture, 7 KM Munshi Marg, Chopati, Radha Gopinath Mandar, Bharati Vidya Vanse, T3 building hai, Baul Nath jane wali gali mein, Bhola class yahan par lagti hai, aap humse address abhi aap jinko chahiye le sakte hai, Sri Govind Prabhu ke lecture 7:30 from Monday to Sunday.
Let me speak.
Yeah, Monday to Sunday, 7:30 to...
Prashad, I would like all of us to chant the Lord's name. Why do we chant the Lord's name? Because we should internally resolve that from today onwards we will try to be true sannyasis. So we'll put off the lights, let us all chant the Lord's name, so that by taking the Lord's name internally, we will request Him to give us the strength to become sannyasis, because you and I cannot become mental sannyasis by...
Let me just make a little arrangement.
Extension bar, na?
Now you are not our guest.
देखो एक प्लेट में पूरी लेकर आओ, पूरी लेकर सब लोगों को अलग से देने का।